Shrimilitam yena tasme Shri Guruve Namaha. Shri Chaitanya mano vishtam sthapitam yena bhutale soyam rupa gadamahiyam dadati swapadantikam. He Krishna Karna Sindhu Dinbandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kantha Radha Kantha Namastute. Saptakanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishbhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Visadi Gaur Bhaktivinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining. Today we are going to do verse 11 of Isopanisad. I was listening to Prabhupada's lecture and he was saying that there are 108 Upanishads, out of which 9 are primary, and out of which Isopanisad is number 1. So let's pay our obeisances to Srila Prabhupada. This verse is about what is Vidya and what is Avidya. Let's pay our obeisances to Shri Radha Govinda, who can give us the intelligence, and Srila Prabhupada for his mercy. This is what we have been doing. Mantra 9 discusses two kinds of people who lack knowledge of Krishna, those who are simply ignorant, and those who are followers of material scholarship, thinking it the end all of knowledge, the end all of knowledge. Both kind of people disregard the Lord's proprietorship and consequently are degraded into the darkest region of ignorance. Mantra 9 describes the result of cultivating ignorance and false knowledge. And mantra 10, we read that true knowledge brings a different result than either of these. It also emphasizes the need to take guidance from a dhira in the act of discriminating between real and illusory knowledge. Okay, and mantra 11 describes how one must know the relative position of material and spiritual knowledge to transcend the material energy and attain deathlessness. Okay, we must be aware of the relative position. Oh, Dr. Raghavendra, it's fine. Thank you for joining. It's fine if you, your network doesn't support because of your travel. So mantra 9 describes how one must know the relative position of material and spiritual knowledge. We must know what is material and we also must know what is spiritual. What is the purpose? To transcend the material energy and attain deathlessness. This is the verse. So I would request few devotees to raise their hands, whoever would like to recite it. Vidyam cha vidyam cha yash tadvedo bhyam saha avidyaya mrityum tritva vidyam ritam ashnute vidyam cha vidyam cha yash tadvedo bhyam saha avidyaya mrityum tritva vidyayam amritam ashnute. All right, so Uma Kanan Mataji, I think you are the always first person to ask.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Vidyam cha vidyam cha yas tad vedho bhayam saha avidyayam mrityum tirtva vidyayam amritam ashnute. Thank you Mataji.
Thank you very much. Very nice. Smita Mataji, please go ahead.
Can
and Shilpaja Mataji. Smita Mataji, please unmute yourself. You got muted again. Smita Mataji. Okay. Go ahead, Mataji. Smita Mataji.
It is muted at your end.
No, you are not muted. We can hear you now. Please go ahead.
Mataji, can you hear me now?
Yes.
I am muted, unmuted.
Yes, we can hear you. Yes.
Mataji, it is muted at your end. Can you hear me now? Yeah.
Yes.
Vidyam cha vidyam cha yas tat vedo bhayam sa avidyayam tritva vidyayam mritam ashnute.
Thank you, Mataji. Shilpaja, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Vidyam cha vidyam cha yas tad vedabhyayam saha avidyayam mrityam tirtva vidyam mritam asmite.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nice. Ritesh, iPad. Ritesh, iPad, Mataji. Ratish, iPad, sorry.
Yeah. Hare Krishna, Mataji. Vidyam cha vidyam cha yas tat vedhobhyam saha avidhyaya mrityam tirtva vidyaya vidya amrtam asnute.
Thank you, Mataji. Priyadarshini, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Vidyam, vidyam cha yas tat vedo bhayam saha avidyaya mrityam tirtva vidyaya amrtam asnute.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nice. Girija, Mataji.
Vidyayam cha vidyayam cha yas tad vidyobhayam saha avidyayam mrityum tirtva vidyayam mrutam ashnute.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Sneha Joshi, Mataji.
Yes, Mataji. Vidyam cha yas tad vedo bhayam saha avidyayam mrityum tirtva vidyaya mamartam ashnute. Hare Krishna,
thank
Mataji.
You, Mataji. Hare Krishna. Sujata Mataji. Sujata Mataji. You can unmute yourself.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Vidyam cha yas tad vidho bhayam saha avidyaya mrityum tirtva vidyayam pratham asnute vidyayam amrutam.
Thank you, Mataji.
Amrutam
ashnute.
Ashnute. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much. Jalpa Parekh, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Vidyam cha yas tad vedo bhayam saha avidyayam mrityam tritva vidyayam artam asnute.
Vidyaya amritam ashnute, deathless.
Vidyayam amritam ashnute.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Thank you. Namita Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Vidyam cha vidyayam chayas tad vedho bhayam saha avidyayam ritam titva vidyayam ritam asute.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna. Duty.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Vidyayam cha vidyam cha yas tad vedo bhyam saha avidyayam mrityum tatva vidyam amritam ashnute.
Very nice. Thank you, Riti. Sharmila Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. I'm good, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Nice to see you.
Vidyam cha yas tad vedo bhyam saha avidyayam mrityum tirtva vidyayam ritam ashnute. Hare Krishna.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Rajni, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Vidyayam cha vidyam cha yash tad vedo bhayam saha avidyayam rityum tirtava vidyayam ritam ashnute. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna. Gayatri KS, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Vidyam cha yas tat vedo bhayam saha avidyaya mrityum tirtva vidyaya amrutam ashnute.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Dr. Indira.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Vidyam cha yas tat vedo bhayam saha avidyaya mrityum tirtva vidyaya amrutam ashnute.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna. Samya Krishna and Mataji.
Vidyam cha yas tad vedho bhayam saha avidyaya mrityum tritva vidyaya mritam ashnute. Hare Krishna.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Manohar Punjabi Prabhu, first Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Mataji. Vidyayam ka vidyayam ka syas tad vedho bhayam saha avidyaya mrityum tritva vidya amritam ashnute.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Thank you, Prabhu. Sorry. Thank you, Prabhu. Simmi Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Krishna. Vidyam cha yas tat vedo bhayam saha avidyaya mrityam tirtva vidyaya amritam ashnute.
Thank you. Very nice, Mataji. Very nice. Dr. Dr. Parekh.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Vidyam cha vidyam cha charyas tad vedo bhayam saha avidyam mrityum titritva vijaya amrutam asnute.
Very nice. Thank you, Dr. Parekh. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Devika Uday Shankar Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Vidyam cha vidyam cha yas tat vedo bhayam saha avidyaya mrityum titva vidyayam mrutam asnute.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Pujya Vrinda Devi Dasi Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Vidyayam cha vidyayam cha yas tat vedo bhayam saha avidyaya mrityum tirtva vidyamrutam ashnute.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna. Okay, Meenakshi Mataji, onward. Please keep your hands raised. It's a big chapter. You will all get the chance to read. So please don't lower your hands. Okay, Meenakshi Mataji, and Jigna Mataji, Vibha, Vijanti Mataji, everyone whose hands are raised, please keep your hands raised because you all will get chance to read. It's a bigger chapter. I'll keep moving. Translation by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Only one who can learn the process of nescience and that of transcendental knowledge side by side can transcend the influence of repeated birth and death and enjoy the full blessings of immortality. I will read one more time. Only one who can learn the process of nescience and that of transcendental knowledge side by side can transcend the influence of repeated birth and death and enjoy the full blessings of immortality. Srila Prabhupada talks about balanced view on life in this particular verse. Miseries of world remind us that we must be engaged in the process of vidya. Both positive direct knowledge and negative indirect knowledge must be there. We just cannot say that we can only have all good and no bad. They're both needed in the material world. Sorry. If you, for example, think that life is bad, you will start to negate it and end up as an impersonalist, right? Nullify. Because body is misery, relationship is misery, job is misery, everything is misery, so there is voidness. Or everything is null and void, right? People who talk like there's nothing at the end, it means that they're going through some bad experience and they're not able to process it. And they're believing in impersonalism. If life is too good, then you add some Krishna to it, then you might end as a sahajiya bhakta or a pretender. Taking Krishna cheaply in material way only to enjoy yourself. So, okay, Krishna has fulfilled my desires. I'm going to take Krishna's name and I'm going to drink this wine. Are sab chalta hai. Let me drink wine, nothing. Or let me smoke one cigarette. Krishna has made all this. Krishna has provided. So this is sahajiya bhakta. Be careful. Sahajiya means mask. The mask is of a bhakta, but there is no devotion in the heart. Be balanced. See defects of material life and use it as the best of a bad bargain. Prabhupada talks of human body in this particular verse as best of a bad bargain. It's a bad bargain. Spirit soul is not supposed to have a body. We are not supposed to have material body, any material body. But we have the best of all material bodies right now. Let's say Prabhupada gives example of the ambassador car. I might have recited it in the past. That there is an ambassador car. It's a very strong car, but it's not working properly. So what will you do? Will you throw away the car? No, you try to use it the best way you can. Like that, a spirit soul is not supposed to have a body. But now we have the best of all material bodies, that is a human body. So use it. It's a bad bargain for a spirit soul to have any material body, but use it to the best of its capacity. Okay, so choice is ours that we want to go ahead with the path of death. Or if we negate it, this life is very hard, then it becomes an impersonalist. If we become sense enjoyer on the name of Krishna, then we become a sahajiya bhakta. There is no balance. The miseries of this world serve to indirectly remind us of our incompatibility with dead matter. Intelligent living entities generally take note of these reminders and engage themselves in the culture of vidya or transcendental knowledge. So meaning of the word vidya is transcendental knowledge. Not vidya that we get in school, the material knowledge. That has its own use to maintain the body, but it doesn't do anything to the soul. So that's really not a real vidya. Okay, real vidya is get out of this ocean of birth and death. Prabhupada gives an analogy of a fever. He says real sense enjoyment is possible when the disease or the fever of materialism is removed. We don't know that spiritual world is full of enjoyment. It is said that every step is a dance over there, and every word is a music, is a song. So people don't walk there, they dance. They don't talk, they sing. And we get the glimpse when we read Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam. Isn't it in the form of songs? We get the glimpse how they talk to each other. So that's what is waiting. A patient must regain his health before he can truly enjoy sense pleasure again, right? Now, sick person, Srila Prabhupada gives the example of a jaundice patient in Nectar of Instruction. Jaundice patient, if you give them a candy, they will taste it as bitter because they're sick. It's not that the candy is bitter, it's sweet, but because of jaundice, it is bitter. But the treatment of jaundice is also a candy. He says that. So if he eats that, he will get rid of the disease. So similarly, we can enjoy the true senses, but we have to do the austerity in the beginning. We must do the austerity. There is got to be a discipline. I must follow the regulative principles. I must chant 16 rounds of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. I must associate with devotees. It looks like an austerity. Must get up early in the morning, but then it will cure my material disease. Thus, the aim of human life is to cure material disease. For example, the normal temperature should be maintained. Balanced program of spiritual and material knowledge. There's got to be a balance. Cultivate spiritual knowledge, but also maintain the body. Okay, if a person is very sick, what can they enjoy? Tell them there's a nice mela, fair outside, let's go. But they are feeling sick. They have no interest, right? They need to regain their health. And then there's going to be an enjoyment. Vedic regulation is for the treatment. Human activities diseased by the tendency towards sense gratification have been regulated in the Vedas under the principles of salvation. This system employs religion, economic development, sense gratification, and salvation or liberation. Okay, so first is religion. Without religion, there is no economic development. Dharma, then artha. And why artha is needed? For kama or sense gratification. And when one gets fed up, there are so many people now, when gets fed up, oh, I have earned enough, I have traveled enough, I have enough assets and I'm still not happy. There are people. Otherwise, why are the millionaires committing suicide? But most of us will know some millionaires who have committed suicide. Why millionaires committed suicide? If that was the aim of happiness, what made them? Or they succumb to some addiction. Because money is not the reason for happiness. Soul is the reason for happiness. Money is needed to maintain the body. It doesn't touch the soul. It does not. Any amount of material qualification does not touch the soul. So I really don't touch myself from that level if I'm not practicing Krishna consciousness. Vedic regulation is made in such a way that if somebody follows the regulation, then there is some concept of superiority, some concept of there is some controller. But who is interested? Is our teaching institute teaching children or adults? Or are we teaching each other about this? No, we are just setting up targets and setting up meetings and trying to invent new gadgets, right? So many things. But there is a need for regulation. At the present moment, people have no interest in religion or salvation, but sense gratification is the aim. The more I can earn, the more I can enjoy my senses, more and more and more. But the more is never more. I was reading Bhagavatam, Ideal Family Life, 7th canto, I think it's 14th chapter, Bhagavatam. Narad Muni was speaking to Yudhishthira Maharaj, and he was saying that a family man who likes to derive pleasure from the family only, just their family, dies very sad. Narad Muni was explaining the whole life is full of sadness because there's always going to be some drama. There's always going to be some sadness. Okay, and then, okay, now they take care of their family. Then they have the family of their children. And then if someone lives long enough, then they have the family of their children's children. So some drama will continue. So Narad Muni was explaining such a person is very sad throughout their life. and they die also very sad. Oh, ho, ho. Sad and sad, but we are looking for, this is my happiness. And if you ask them, what is your happiness? What makes you happy? Oh, if my children are very well educated, if my grandchildren are not sick, that makes me happy. Really? Really? Then what about you as a soul? What about you as a part and parcel of Krishna? What about you as a child of Krishna? Okay, only Krishna can give protection. Krishna, Krishna, Mahabaho, Bhakta Nam Abhayankaraha, Tvam Ekam, Dhaya Mana Nam Apavargo Hi Samshite. Arjuna prays to Krishna in 7th chapter, 1st Canto Bhagavatam. Krishna, Krishna, Mahabaho, only you can instill fearlessness in the hearts of your devotees. Only you, Krishna. Arjuna says, Tvam Ekam. Krishna says, Mam Ekam. That is a relationship. Yes, you're right, Mam Ekam. The path of religion is actually meant for self-realization. Actually, it is meant for self-realization. But what we do, we use religion for economic development, not self-realization. Salvation is the same as liberation. Devotees are already saved, but they don't ask to stop suffering. That's a very high Mahabhagavata. I'm not at that level. And I'm asking Krishna, make me suffer. Or Queen Kunti saying, bring those sufferings again and again. That's a very high level of devotion to Krishna. That person is a Mahabhagavata. Okay, devotee who's chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra sincerely is already liberated from the clutches of Yamaraj. Srila Prabhupada has said, if you have chanted Hare Krishna Mahamantra in your life, you will not see Yamaraj even in your dream. Even in the dream. Okay, so we have this thing, 15th chapter Bhagavad Gita. Urdhva Mula Madhav Shakham Ashwattham Prahur Avyayam Chandam Si Yasya Parnani Yastam Veda Sa Veda Vid. Upside down banyan tree. Upside down. Whatever is highest there is lowest here. Over there, the spiritual sense enjoyment is highest. Here, there is no spiritual sense enjoyment. Just jump from one branch to another branch to another branch. So that is, this knowledge is Vidya. This knowledge is Vidya. Everything else is avidya. Who doesn't talk about this? We may have so many titles after our name, but how much are we successful in stopping our death? How much? That is Vidya. Prabhupada says in this lecture that Vyasdev, who can be more scholarly than Vyasdev? Who can be more scholarly? He's writing 100,000 verses, and each verse that he writes, we can spend our life. Actually, each verse of Bhagavad Gita, we can spend months and months in discussion. There's so much depth. But what is his standard of living? What is his standard of living? He's living in Badrika Ashram in a hut. So Vidya and Avidya produce different results. That is why we have to know each both side by side. Vidya brings immortality and Avidya brings bondage. We should understand Vidya and Avidya together, in order to recognize, not to fall in a trap of material existence. Understand, where are you going? Prabhupada gives example that he's walking on a beach. When he was walking on a beach, he said, I was very careful not to get my shoes wet, right? So I am aware where the land is and where the sea is. So be careful where Vidya is and where Avidya is, because the results are different. Different. What we associate, that's where our independence lies. We have to understand what the material world is about and learn how to deal with it to go back home, back to Godhead. We are not going to stay here permanently, right? Dukhalyam ashashvatam. It's a temporary word. It's just a matter of time when my death is coming. It's inevitable. But right now I have this chance where I can become deathless, where I can regain my spiritual identity and I can go to Krishna. And Krishna will take care of me, right? So Prabhupada, this is Vidya. Prabhupada said, in my absence, you read the books. What I have to talk, I have written in the books. You can associate with me by reading my books. So Srila Prabhupada gives his personal association to the person who reads his book. Why would you not take a chance of losing, of associating with such an exalted Acharya? He says it. He has himself said it. But what are we doing? This is what we are doing. Entertainment is an addiction. Is it really an entertainment? This is an excerpt from New York Times article. I'm not making it up. We thought we could control it. This is going to the pleasure centers of the developing brain. On the scale between candy and crack cocaine, this is closer to crack cocaine. I am convinced the devil lives in our phones and is weakening havoc, is wrecking havoc on our children. This is so many, okay, we have educational app, okay, we have this app, that app. No, it's an addiction. How do we know what is spiritual and what is material? How do we know? The way we use something determines it. For example, if we use something material in Krishna's service, it is not material anymore, but spiritual. On the other side, if human activities like communism, etc. are not transformed, then they stay material. Okay, Srila Prabhupada traveled in cars. We can say this is material, but no, spiritual, because Prabhupada is using it to preach Krishna consciousness, not like me going to sense gratificatory places. Or Prabhupada traveled in airplanes. The material, we can say it's material, but no, it is spiritual, because the Acharya is using it for the service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Okay, we studied in Mantra 9 that Krishna can convert matter into spirit and spirit into matter, right? The touch of Krishna. Okay, so tell me, I have a video which I have in my DVD. You want to watch the 6 minutes or should we read first? What do you want to do?
Watch
the video first. Wait. Oh, I'm so sorry. You cannot talk to me. Yes, please tell me, what do you want to do first?
We'll watch first. Watch the video.
Everybody's spoiled. Okay. Okay, fine. Okay, Hare Krishna. Everybody's spoiled. So this is, I have a DVD of, I have Prabhupada's DVD. So I'm going to play first 6 minutes, not the 35 minutes. Okay. Just 6 minutes.
Who is Srila Prabhupada? People often ask. At various times, he was known as a scholar, a philosopher, a cultural ambassador, a prolific author, a religious leader, a spiritual teacher, a social critic, and a holy man. He was not one of those modern entrepreneurial gurus who come to the West with slickly packaged, watered-down versions of Eastern spirituality, promising instant well-being to anyone who could spare $50. Srila Prabhupada was rather a true holy man, one who could be called an Acharya, which means a spiritual master who teaches by example. After arriving in the United States in 1965 at the age of 69, Srila Prabhupada formed the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, which developed into a worldwide spiritual community with hundreds of ashrams, schools, temples, and farms, and with thousands of dedicated disciples who made Hare Krishna a household word. To have achieved all this in only 12 years was remarkable, but before he passed away from this world in 1977, Srila Prabhupada had also written and published over 80 volumes of translation and commentary on the great spiritual classics of ancient India. His books were welcomed with great critical acclaim by the Western academic community and by scholars from India as well, and they became standard texts in almost every university and library around the world. Srila Prabhupada had also succeeded in transmitting the profound wisdom of the ancient Vedic culture in a form and style that was clearly understandable to the average modern man. He could somehow explain even the most difficult philosophical concepts to people who were totally unfamiliar with the complex Indian religious tradition. Srila Prabhupada circled the globe 11 times between 1966 and 1977, and everywhere he went, he taught the same basic truths, the fundamental principles of religion, that constitute the cornerstone of spiritual understanding for everyone, no matter what their nationality or religion. Srila Prabhupada was, more than anything, a teacher, a professor emeritus of the science of self-realization. And he was the best kind of teacher, because he always lived up to what he taught.
They also say that no one can ever be pure
that everyone is doomed to be
and
a sinner.
That is, apavat mannate jagat. That is the conditioned soul's qualification, that he is a fool, he thinks other fools. Yes. Everyone, he thinks he is like me. That is nature. Atvavat mannate jagat. Everyone thinks others like himself. If he's a fool, he thinks all are. So these things are no argument. Nobody has seen God. How do you take the statistics? Can you say like that, any statistics that nobody has? Maybe you have not seen him, one has seen God. That is quite possible, because you have not scrutinizedly studied all the men of the world.
Yes.
Then how you can say nobody has seen? You have not seen the man who has seen him.
So the man...
He will not admit his fault. He will accuse others. Nobody has seen that. Why? You may not have seen, but why you say nobody has seen? You have not seen that person who has seen God. Therefore, you say like that.
Prabhupada, listen to Prabhupada every day. Okay, you can tell me. Nice? Do you like it?
Yes.
Yes, Mataji. It was very Mataji.
Very nice, Mataji.
Yes, Mataji.
Touching it is.
Very nice. Thank you, Mataji.
Yes, Mataji.
Very nice, Mataji.
Beautiful.
Very nice.
Beautiful. Inspiring. Prabhupada is beautiful. Thank you. Okay, so who? Meenakshi Mittal Mataji, please go ahead. Please start reading.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Vidyam cha yastad vedobhyam saha avidyaya mrityum titva vidyamritam ashnute. Translation: only one who can learn the process of nescience and that of transcendental knowledge side by side can transcend the influence of repeated birth and death and enjoy the full blessings of immortality. Purport: since the start of the material world, everyone is trying for a permanent life, but the law of nature is so cruel that no one has avoided the hand of death. No one wants to die. This is practical fact. Nor does anyone want to become old or diseased. But the law of nature does not allow anyone immunity from death, old age, or disease. The advancement of material knowledge has not solved these problems of life. Material science can discover the nuclear bomb to accelerate the process of death, but it cannot discover anything which can protect man from the cruel hands of death, disease, and old age. From the Puranas, we learn of the activities of Hiranyakashipu. This king was materially very much advanced, and by his material acquisitions, by the strength of his nescience, he wanted to conquer death. He underwent a type of meditation so severe that all the planetary systems became disturbed by his mystic powers. He forced the creator of universe, the demigod named Brahma, to come down to him, and then he asked him for the benediction of becoming an Amar, one who does not die. Brahma refused to award this, however, because even he, the material creator, who has command over all the planets, is not himself an Amara. He has a long duration of life, as is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita, but that does not mean that he doesn't have to die. Hiranya means gold, and Kashipu means soft bed. This gentleman was interested in those two things, money and women, and he wanted to enjoy this sort of life by becoming artificially immortal. He asked Brahma many things indirectly in hopes of fulfilling his desire to become an Amara. He asked benediction that he might not be killed by any man, animal, god, or any living being within the categories of the 8,48,400,000 species. He also asked that he might not die on the land, in the air, in the water, or by any weapon whatsoever. So on and on. Hiranyakashipu thought foolishly that this would guarantee him against death. But in the end, although Brahma granted him all these benedictions, he was killed by the personality of Godhead in the form of a half man, half lion. And no weapon was used to kill him except the nails of the Lord. He was killed on the lap of the wonderful living being who was beyond his conception.
Thank you, Mataji.
The whole point here is
thank you.
Krishna.
Very nicely read. Hi, Krishna. So, Jignataji, you can unmute yourself for the next one. So, Prabhupada is saying that we all want to be immortal because that's the nature of the spirit. Spirit doesn't die, soul doesn't die. There is no birth. Then, what is the question of death? Death is for person who has taken birth, but spirit is eternal. So the advancement of material knowledge has not solved these problems of life. It's causing distraction. We lose the focus. We don't talk about the main stuff. The main problem is, I don't want to grow old. I don't want to get disease. I don't want to die. We discover new and new treatments, but the diseases also keep increasing. They keep increasing. This coronavirus was unheard of. Right? We still don't know what is the proper treatment. But the new and new wars, pestilence, and diseases come up. And then we conquer it, and then we think that we are successful. And then something else pops up, and then we conquer that, and then we think we are successful. And something else pops up. What about the death? This is just a reminder that we actually don't belong here. Hiranya means gold, Kashipu means soft. I really like Prabhupada is so nice. He's calling Hiranyakashipu a gentleman. This gentleman was was interested in these two things, money and woman. We don't call such people gentlemen, but Prabhupada is writing it here. And he asked for so many benedictions from Brahma to become immortal. And he thought he fooled Brahma. He fooled Krishna. But what happened? Who would have imagined that how Krishna is going to come and kill him? So death is inevitable for someone who is not Krishna conscious. There's so many examples that Srila Prabhupada gives. He gives the example of a cat. If a cat is holding a rat in the mouth, that mouth of cat represents death for the rat, right? But the same cat, if she's holding her own kittens, her own children in her mouth, that is the safest place. It is like that. Okay, Jigna Mataji, please go ahead. The whole point here is that
Mataji, from this process, right?
Yeah, Mataji, keep your mic little away from your mouth.
This process of going back to Godhead, right, Mataji?
The whole point is that even Hiranyakashipu.
The whole point here is that even Hiranyakashipu, the most powerful of the materialist, who could not become deathless by his various plans, what then will be accomplished by the tiny Hiranyakashipu of today, who make plans which are throttled from moment to moment? Sri Isopanisad instructs us not to make a one-sided attempt to win the struggle for existence. Everyone is struggling hard for existence, but the law of material nature is so hard that fast it does not allow any to surpass it. In order to have permanent life, one must be prepared to go back to Godhead. This process of going back to Godhead is a different branch of knowledge, and it has to be learned from the revealed Vedic scriptures such as Upanishad, Vedanta, Bhagavad Gita. Srimad Bhagavatam, etc. Therefore, to become happy in this life and to get permanent blissful life after leaving this material body, one must take to this sacred literature and obtain the transcendental knowledge. The conditioned living being has forgotten his eternal relation with God, and he has mistakenly accepted the temporary place of birth as all in all. The Lord has kindly delivered the above mentioned scriptures in India and other scriptures in other countries to remind the forgetful human being that his home is not here in this material world. The living being is a spiritual entity, and he can only be happy by returning to his spiritual home and with the Godhead.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nice. Thank you so much. Vibha, you can unmute. So Prabhupada is again saying Hiranyakashipu also was not able to, big demon was also not able to live forever. So what to speak of small demons who are planning to do, to invent immortality by materialistic gadgets or materialistic means. We really cannot solve a material problem by a material thing. We cannot solve the problem. The material problem has to be given a spiritual solution. Each and every material problem. There is no material problem which can be solved by another material thing. I can't think of anything. For example, when India was under British rule, it was a problem, right? And they thought, okay, we are going to get India back. But then what happened? It got divided into two countries. Then what happened? Okay, now stay happy. Then what happened? Within each country, there are still wars. There are still arguments about this tract of land and this tract of land, right? And between countries also, there is a fight. So it has not really solved the problem. It has really not. But if we cultivate a spiritual culture, we say, okay, this Isha Vashyam Idam Sarvam. This all belongs to Krishna. Let us use everything in service to Krishna. That is called United Nations. That is United Nations. I showed you the video of a boy, Gurukul boy, right? Purushottam, last week, or Friday maybe, right? Where he was saying this boy is from Ecuador, this boy is from Taiwan, this boy is from Coimbatore, this boy is from this particular place. So that is United Nations. They're all living together with one conception that we are going to serve Krishna, we are brahmacharis, we are under Guru. That, only that. So a material problem cannot have. So if I want to stop my death, I must adopt the spiritual culture of life. No amount of Botox injections, no amount of life prolonging pills, or no amount of, anti-wrinkle creams. I'm going to solve my problem. They're not going to solve my problem, okay? That's a patchwork, or no amount of hair color is actually going to prevent my color from becoming gray. Okay, Vibha, go ahead. The personality of Godhead.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. The personality of Godhead from his kingdom sends his bona fide servants to propagate this mission of going back to Godhead. And sometimes he comes himself to do this work. All living beings are his beloved sons, his parts and parcel, and therefore God is more sorry than we ourselves are for the sufferings which we are constantly undergoing in the material condition. The miseries of the material world are also indirect reminders of our incompatibility with dead matter, and intelligent living entities generally take note of these reminders and side by side engage themselves in the culture of Vidya or transcendental knowledge. Human life is the best opportunity for the culture of spiritual knowledge, and the human being who does not take advantage of this opportunity in human life is called a Naradhama, the lowest Naradhama, the lowest of human beings.
Thank you, Vibha. Thank you. It has some important points. So Prabhupada is again reinforcing that this is a bad bargain. Krishna is saying all living beings, Sarvayonishukandaya, all living beings. He is not saying only human beings. He is not saying only so-called Hindus. He is not saying only so-called people in India. He's saying all living beings. This means that not only in the human form of life, but also animal form, plant form, aquatic form, demigod form, living entities in the hellish planets. There are living entities everywhere. When you get yourself ready to go to Krishna, your vision is broadened so much. So much. You don't belong to a well anymore. So all living beings are his beloved sons, his parts and parcels, and God is more sorry than we ourselves for the suffering which we are constantly undergoing in the material condition. Krishna is affected. That is why Krishna sends us these reminders, scriptures, acharyas. Come back to me. Come back. You belong to me. This is not the place. This is not the place. But then we try to make ourselves very comfortable by putting an Apple TV with a lot of control, or driving an electric car which is self-driven, or getting a very high degree. I'm not saying that don't do that, but don't think that is the ultimate goal of life. That's an adjustment for me to live to a particular standard for my bodily comforts. The soul is not attached. That is why there is always this unhappiness. Okay, please understand. This is a very important verse. Please understand what is vidya and please understand what is avidya. Okay, Vishanti Mataji, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna. The path of avidya or material advancement of knowledge for sense gratification means repetition of death and repetition of birth also. The living entity, as he is spiritually, has no birth or death. Birth and death are concerned with the outward covering of the spirit soul, the body. This is compared with the putting on and talking of outward garments. Foolish human beings who are grossly absorbed in the culture of avidya, nisayans, do not mind this cruel process, but being enamored of the beauty of the illusionary energy, they do the same things over repeatedly without learning any lessons from the law of nature. The culture of vidya or transcendental knowledge is essential for the human being. Unrestricted sense enjoyment in the deceased material condition of the senses must be restricted as far as possible. Unrestricted sense enjoyment in this bodily condition is the path of ignorance and death. The living entities are not without spiritual senses. Every living being in his original spiritual form has all the senses which are now material covered by the body and the mind. Activities of the material senses are perverted reflections of spiritual pastimes. The engagement of the spirit soul under the material covering is the diseased condition of the soul. And real sense enjoyment is possible when the disease is removed. In our pure spiritual form, freed from all material contamination, pure enjoyment of the senses is possible. The aim of human life should therefore not be perverted sense enjoyment, but should be to cure the material disease. Aggravating the material disease is no sign of knowledge. It is the sign of culturing avidya, ignorance.
Thank you, Hare Krishna, Mataji. Hare Krishna. So, So, Prabhupada is again saying that what is knowledge and what is ignorance. So far, what have we discussed? So far, we discussed that no amount of material advancement can solve my real problem. So I have to go to my real self, which is soul. And where is the soul coming from? Krishna. Does soul die? No. Why it doesn't die? Because it doesn't take birth. And then Isopanisad instructs us not to make one-sided attempt to win the struggle for existence. Everyone is struggling. We will not win this struggle ever. Right? There is this theory, survival of the fittest. Survival of the fittest. So nobody will survive, actually. Nobody will survive. It's actually just a matter of time. Survival of the fittest means eternal survival, which we are not doing anything about. Srila Prabhupada was asked in Chicago by one of the journalists. I'm sorry if I have said this before, but I told this to people at my work also, that Prabhupada was asked that, Prabhupada, why is mortality rate so high in India? Is the medical system not very good? maternal mortality rate, infant mortality rate, mortality rate. People are dying so much in India. So much they're dying. Is the medical system at fault? What seems to be the issue? Srila Prabhupada said mortality rate is same everywhere. 100%. It is same everywhere. 100%. So but this is the Acharya. You cannot confuse or divert the attention of an Acharya. We, in human form of life, has the privilege of taking advantage of the scriptures, of the saintly people who teach us the real deathlessness. Okay, not the patchwork. The material civilization teaches patchwork. You turn on a radio or turn on TV or open your newspaper. Anywhere you go, there is going to be lots of advertisements. And the advertisements are made in such a manner that they convince the person that, okay, if you don't have it, if you're not wearing this designer clothes, then you're really not worn anything in your life. Right? It feels like that, right? Once I watched on the TV, mascara ad, mascara. So the lady, like the mascara, it was like plumbing the eyelashes and it was like so nicely curled. So for a second I thought, oh, okay, if you don't have a mascara, your eyelashes are useless. So is it like that? No. No, it's a patchwork. It's a diversion. You know, because there's this conception of beauty. And where is this conception coming from? If I did not have this knowledge, then I would have gone and purchased a mascara. But Prabhupada saved me. This is not needed. It's not a need. It's not going to lead me to Vidya. I'm not saying that putting it is wrong, but there's got to be some understanding behind it. Why am I doing what I'm doing? Okay. And one who does not cultivate this is called Naradhama, lowest of the human being. Naradhama. Okay, avidya or material advancement means that we are progressing towards sense gratification. And sense gratification means repetition of death and birth. Repeatedly we die, repeatedly we take birth. Okay, so culture of vidya is essential for human being because unrestricted sense enjoyment makes us diseased. Material conditioning of senses must be restricted. Please mind the words. Prabhupada is not saying that stop the sense enjoyment. He's saying restrict. There's a difference between restriction and stopping. Okay, the word used is restrict. Unrestricted sense enjoyment in the diseased material condition of senses must be restricted as far as possible. We restrict ourselves, right? For example, eating. We don't say don't eat, we eat, but it is restricted to certain paradigm of food. This is what is offerable to Krishna and this is what my diet is going to consist of. Other than that, I don't eat. But it's not said that don't eat. It's not said that don't sleep. Maximum 6 hours is enough. One can practice. Okay, we are not saying that don't have family. Have family, get married. Don't live like animals. There's so many things. No gambling, because gambling is going to take away the truthfulness. Like that. The aim of human life is therefore not perverted sense enjoyment, but to cure the material disease. We are diseased. There is a disease. Death, birth, old age, and a disease is a disease. It's a disease. Okay, Mataji, please go ahead. Shobha, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. The degree of a fever must not be from 105 to 107 for good health. The degree is to be reduced to the normal state of 98.6. That should be the aim of the human life. The modern trend of material civilization is to increase the degree of the feverish material condition, which has therefore reached the point of 107 in the form of atomic energy. With the foolish politicians crying that at any moment the world may go to hell. That is the result of the advancement of material knowledge and of the neglect of the most important part of life, the culture of spiritual knowledge. Here is a warning in Sri Isopanisad that we must not follow such a dangerous path leading to death. On the contrary, we must side by side develop the culture of spiritual knowledge so that we may become completely free from the cruel hands of death. this does not mean that all the civic activities for the maintenance of the body should be stopped. There is no question of stopping activities, as there is no question of wiping out one's temperature altogether when trying to recover from a disease. We have already tried to explain the matter by the expression, to make the best use of a bad bargain. The culture of spiritual knowledge has to be done with the help of this body and mind. And therefore, maintenance of the body and mind is required if we are to reach our goal. The normal temperature should be maintained at 98.6 degrees, but it should not be foolishly increased to a degree of 107. The great sages and saints of India wanted to maintain the normal temperature by a balanced program of material and spiritual knowledge. They never allowed the misuse of human intelligence for disease sense gratification.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nicely, Mataji. Thank you. Very sweet voice. Meeta Mataji will be next.
Yes, Mataji.
So, again, Prabhupada is saying strike a balance. Strike a balance between spiritual and material life. And how do we strike a balance? What does it really mean by striking a balance? It means that understand that I have a body and the body has material needs. The body has material needs, but I also got to meet the need of my soul. And out of the two, meeting the need of the soul is more important. Yes, I agree that unless and until I have sufficient food to eat, unless and until I have sufficient rest, unless and until I have sufficient amount of skill set, it will be hard for me to chant Hare Krishna. Yes, I agree. So just get sufficient. Don't make a kingdom. Prabhupada was saying in the lecture that if you go to a very big businessman, okay, they're very rich. Let's say the businessman is very rich, where, like they have lakhs and crores of assets. And you tell them, please hear about Krishna. What will they say? That they have no time. Here, you take your contribution of money and please let me do my business and please go away, right? And Prabhupada said that because the karma, the lust is not satisfied, more and more and more. What about then we die there under all the assets, there is this death. It's a serious problem, actually. It's a very serious problem. It's yes, we can do the business. He's not saying don't stop the business, but cultivate what is real self. Cultivate and understand that what is the aim of life? Why is Krishna, what is the reason behind this human form of life? What is the real reason? The real reason is not so that I can open empires and empires of these things. Otherwise, Bhagavatam would have spoken about it at least once. At least once it would have spoken about it, but I don't. There's no mention. We can build empires and empires if it is for propagating Krishna consciousness. Like Prabhupada built this empire of International Society for Krishna Consciousness. It is the biggest organization in the whole world right now. The biggest. Everywhere you go in the world, any part of the world, we are all sitting at different parts. Most of you are in India, but not everyone. Anywhere you are, there is going to be someone around you who's chanting Hare Krishna. So famous. Prabhupada did it. So you can chant Hare Krishna. Okay, you want to leave this place and you want to move to that place. Okay, but catch this sound vibration. Okay? Geeta Mataji, go ahead.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Mataji. Human activities diseased by a temperament of sense gratification have been regulated in the Vedas under the principles of salvation. This system is found in four divisions: religion, economic development, sense gratification, and salvation. At the present moment, the people have no interest either in religion or salvation. They have only one aim in life, sense gratification. And in order to fulfill this end, they have different plans for economic development. Misguided man thinks that religion should be maintained for its contribution to economic development, and that economic development is required for sense gratification. And in order to guarantee further sense gratification after death in heaven, there is some system of religious observances. But this is not the purpose of the principles of salvation. The path of religion is actually for self-realization. Economic development is required just to maintain the body in a sound, healthy condition. a man should live in a healthy condition of life with a sound mind just to realize vidya, true knowledge, which is the aim of human life. This life is not meant for working like an ass or for the culture of avidya or for sense gratification.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nicely read.
Thank you, Mataji.
Very affirmatively read. Very strong. You're very strong. So human activities are diseased by temperament or sense gratification. It's a disease. Any indulgence in any kind of sense gratification leads to more conditioning. It leads to more conditioning of the mind. You can think of anything. Let's say somebody likes to hear a lot of sense gratificatory music. Their consciousness is changed. Or they watch, like entertainment I showed you. It's the number one addiction of the whole world. We are undermining the importance of addiction of entertainment in today's world. But it is number one. Because it is not taught properly, it is an addiction. Anything that makes me go on doing it and it really does not serve the purpose of life is an addiction. That's the definition of an addiction. I do it and it doesn't serve any purpose. It makes me unhealthy. People are sleeping less. They have so many sleep issues. Children have sleep issues of all the people because of video games. Or there is no skill set behind it. There is no skill set. I was at a training one time in developmental pediatrics and they showed us that these video games were actually invented for military training, for target military training. That was the real invention behind the video games. But then now it has become so popular. And what does it teach? That it's okay to kill someone if they don't do what you want. It changes the consciousness. It's just not about playing. It's a consciousness that's touched because a person is living. You're dealing with a dead matter. A living person dealing with a dead matter is going to get infected. A living person dealing with a living matter. That is why relationship is so important with devotees. That is why association with devotees is important. Acharyas are important. And Prabhupada called this person misguided. A person who thinks that I will do religion so that I can have sense gratification and economic development is a misguided person. Misguided. Understand Prabhupada's language, please. He's saying misguided. You're not guided properly. Use the religion for self-realization. But what are we using it for? Economic development. Let me earn more. Let me do this puja. And then my work will be more successful. And then I will earn more. And then I will buy my favorite choice of liquor. Really? Okay, Lakshmi Mataji, go ahead. Mataji can unmute. Lakshmi Nishtala Mataji.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
The path of Vidya is most perfectly presented in the Srimad Bhagavatam. The Bhagavatam directs human being to utilize his life in a matter of inquiring about the absolute truth. The absolute truth is realized step by step as Brahma, Paramatma, and at last Bhagavan, the personality of Godhead. The absolute truth is realized by the broad-minded man who has attained knowledge and detachment, having followed the 18 principles of Bhagavad Gita described above. The central point in these 18 principles is the attainment of transcendental devotional service to the personality of Godhead. Therefore, it is recommended for all classes of men to learn the art of devotional service to the Lord. Religiousness, economic development, and sense gratification without the aim of attaining devotional service to the Lord are all different forms of nisayance, as will be shown hereafter in Sri Isopanisad. Thus, to culture Vidya, especially in this age, one must always hear and chant and worship with concentrated attention targeted on the personality of Godhead, who is the Lord of Transcendentalists.
Very nice. Thank you very much, Mataji. Like, let's say there's an epidemic, and what is the best cure for epidemic? Vaccination, right? Like that, we are in the epidemic of nisayans all the time, life after life. So what do we have to do? Vaccinate with what? Holy name. Chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra constantly. Constantly, Kirtanya Sada Hari has to be the game. It has to be the goal. Kirtanya Sada Hari, it's not easy. It's not easy. The mind has so many noises that we have to catch that, okay, did I just not chant Hare Krishna in my mind? What was I doing? random thoughts coming from here and there, right? And when one sits down to chant Hare Krishna, then these thoughts bubble up and show up again. Let the mind do its own business. You do the business between ear and tongue. That's the only game. That's the only way out. There is no other way. If there was, then the Shastras would have told us, but they are not. Read Srimad Bhagavatam, because Srimad Bhagavatam is presenting the concept of Vidya in the most perfect manner. If I have attained a human form of life and I have not read Bhagavatam, oh, that's a loss. You know how when some of our friends, they meet us and say, oh, if you haven't checked out this place in the mall, then really your life is useless. I have some friends who talk like that. So I want to say to all of you, if you haven't checked out Srimad Bhagavatam in the human form of life, then there is a big loss there. Open it and know who Krishna is. Srimad Bhagavatam tells who Krishna is. Okay. So ready for the buzzer round? Everyone, please lower your hands so we can have the buzzer round. I have two questions only. Kindly, please don't mind. I'm just going to lower the hands so I can ask question. Okay. Give the English meaning of the name Hiranyakashipu. People who have not spoken even once in this class. Malvika Singh Mataji, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Hiranya means gold and Kashipu means soft bed.
So gentleman.
gentleman. Very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Okay. Next question. The miseries of this material world serve to indirectly remind us of what? Yes. The miseries of this material world serve to remind us of what? Who have not spoken even once in this class? I see Matajis are rocking. All of you rock. Any of my co-hosts, if you want to answer and you can't raise your hand, please unmute yourself. All these Matajis have spoken today. Jigirija Mataji, Minakshi Mataji, Priyadashni Mataji, Jalpa Mataji. Yes, Seema Mataji. The miseries of material existence remind us of what? Mataji can unmute.
Give me a minute.
What?
Mataji, I'm a little...
Okay. Yeah. Hare Krishna. Annapurna Mataji, you can unmute yourself, please. The miseries of material existence remind us of what?
Hare Krishna.
Okay, Anvaya Mataji. Pooja Vrinda Mataji, we have also spoken. 1 second. Anvaya Mataji.
Mataji. Hare Krishna, that we must be engaged in the process of Krishna consciousness.
Okay, very nice. Thank you, Mataji. Anyone else? Okay. Then I will choose.
See, I've not spoken. I've just read the verse.
Okay, go ahead, Mataji.
I hope I'm not wrong. See, the miseries of this material world serve to indirectly remind us of what means? That this world is dukhalim ashashvatam.
Okay, thank you, Mataji. Very nice. Namita Mataji. The miseries of material world remind us of this, that we are incompatible with the dead matter. Oh, Namita, you can unmute.
Hare Krishna, I'm Namita's daughter.
Huh?
I'm Namita's daughter.
Oh yeah, Namita Mataji's daughter. Okay. Hare Krishna.
The miseries of this material world remind us that we should go back to Godhead and that we are suffering in this material world.
Very nice. Thank you. You're a medical student, right? I've seen you. Yes?
I'm a doctor. Yes.
Oh, you're working already? You look like a student. Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. The miseries of this material world serve to indirectly remind us of our incompatibility with dead matter. We are incompatible, like oil and water. Okay, this is what it is. Okay, thank you so much for your enthusiastic Yeah, we are not going to be here forever. That's good. For enthusiastic participation, this batch is the best batch of all the classes that I have. Very good participation. Anyone has any questions? Okay, I'm going to lower the hand so we can take question answer for a few minutes, for 5 minutes maybe. Please don't mind, I'm just lowering the hands because I need to know who's raising hand for questions. Okay, if you have a question, please raise your hand again. Khushbu, yes, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Mataji, this line that mentions religion should be maintained for its contribution to economic development and that economic development is required for sense gratification. Mataji, can you explain this? I didn't understand this point.
Well, this was in context. You have to go on reading. Religion, this was in context. Where is this?
Mataji, it is in the third last paragraph.
1, 2, 3. Human activities diseased by temperament or sense gratification?
No. Mataji, misguided man thinks that religion should be maintained.
For its contribution to economic development and that economic development is required for sense gratification. What is your question?
Mataji, I didn't understand the relation between this line. I mean, I didn't understand the line itself.
The person who is misguided thinks that religion is required for economic development. You know that this puja, that puja, you have heard of it, right? Must have heard of it. I'm going to do this fasting so that this desire is fulfilled. Haven't you heard of this?
Yes.
Or I will do this charity so I can get this gain in my personal life, right? So that's a misconception. It's a misconception because the purpose of the path of religion is actually for self-realization, but we are misusing the independence, misusing it. Prabhupada is saying, use it properly. Cultivate religion to cultivate self-realization and not to cultivate economic development.
Mataji, what we're talking, so that is self-realization.
No, it's not self-realization. Yeah, I'm fasting so that I can get $100 million. Where is self-realization? Self is soul. Where is the realization that I'm the soul? And why I want $100 million so I can enjoy more and I can exploit more material nature, right?
Then Mataji, what is categorized in the self-realization? I'm sorry, I'm just getting confused.
Self-realization is knowing that I am the soul. I am not the body itself. I am part and parcel of Krishna. I have a relationship over there. That's my home. I'm a visitor here. That is realization.
Okay.
That I'm not supposed to die. I'm not supposed to suffer. I'm not supposed to be diseased. I think this information is very attractive, right? It's very attractive. If somebody is suffering and you tell them, you're not supposed to die. My friend's mother was passing away 2019, August. Yeah, we were taking care of her. And every day I would go and meet her and I would say, Mommy, do you want to go to a place where you can be with the cows and everyone? Like, you know, we used to talk and she was really suffering. And immediately her eyes were light up. I saw it. I used to tell her, do you want to go to a place where there's enjoyment, there's dance in every step, where there's no disease? And her eyes were lit up that, yeah, I want to. I'm suffering here. So that is self-realization, going there.
Okay, Mother.
That's it, Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hi. Duty.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Mataji, there is a term called Amara, which is being emphasized in the paragraph where Hiranyakashipu is being described. Yes. So, Mataji, what is Amara? I could not understand that. What is the meaning?
Yeah, so Mara means death, condemned to death. A in Sanskrit means not. That is why it is said in the beginning. Anything. A means not. So when you put A in front of Mara, it becomes that which does not die. So he did not want to die. Amara.
Okay, thank you so much, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Girija, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
It's mentioned that activities of material senses are perverted the reflections of spiritual pastimes. I didn't understand it.
I didn't touch on that, but thank you for bringing it up. Yes. So, for example, material sense gratification. For example, I have a tendency to enjoy with my family, right? I have this tendency to have my children look very beautiful and well-educated, and I want to enjoy with them. Right or wrong? Mataji, are you there?
Yes, Mataji.
So, right or wrong that I have this this conception in me that my happiness is with my family, with my children? Yes? So that means, but the deeper question is, where is this coming from? Where is this coming from, really? Who told me? I did not learn this in the school, or it is known even to a small child that I can be happy only with my parents. This conception is coming from where? It's coming from because I actually belong to Krishna's family. We try to maintain our family, but nobody will stay for forever. We know that. But we plan like this, we're going to stay forever. And where is this conception of forever is coming from? It's coming from Krishna. So it's perverted. I'm trying to be happy with this family, thinking it is forever. But there is something forever somewhere else. I'm just not looking in the right direction. Am I making sense or making up jugglery of words? Are you understanding?
Yeah, I'm understanding.
So Urdhva Moolam Adoshakam, I am looking for immortality and eternal happiness, but I am looking at the wrong place. I am looking in the material world, but that doesn't mean that there is not a place where this is happening. It is happening in spiritual world. Prabhupada gives example. It just came to my mind. Let's say that somebody is looking for water. You know the mirage in the desert, like there is this conception of water, then the sun is shining over a very hot sand. It looks like there is water, right? It's a mirage. So person is looking, okay, this is water, but there is no water there. But that doesn't mean that there is no water at all anywhere. It is there, but it's just not there. This conception, so conception of material enjoyment is there, but it's really coming from spiritual enjoyment. I'm supposed to be enjoying eternally in eternal family of Krishna, but somehow I'm looking for it here. So it's perverted. Okay. Think about it. If you don't understand, then get back.
Yeah, I got it, Mataji. I think I got it. Yeah.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you.
Shilpa Ja, Mataji.
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Mataji, Brahma was not Amara, you said, na?
The Prabhupada is writing here, yes. And Bhagavad Gita 4 chapter gives the duration of life of Brahma also.
But what I know is that during Samudra Manthana, the Amruta, he also had, na? All the gods had.
That doesn't make them immortal. Please read Bhagavatam. It says that you're going to have a very long duration of life. It doesn't say that you're going to not die, but it says you're going to live for a long time. Two different things.
Yeah, I was confused, Mataji, because Brahma also has lifespan. Brahma and even a small ant. I know that, but I was confused, so I asked.
Yeah, but drinking nectar does not mean that one is not going to die. It just means you're going to live longer and live like a healthy person, but you will still die.
Thank you, Mataji.
Yeah, Krishna. Lakshmi Nishthala Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Yeah, you said, Mataji, that Krishna gives opportunity to all the souls, be it human beings or animals also, to go to spiritual world. So animals also, they can't chant, then how do they get the opportunity to go to spiritual world, Mataji?
Well, you just have to read the Dashavatar Stotra. First is the first avatar, Matsavatar, fish.
Yes,
so Krishna came in the aquatic family, then Kurma avatar. So the animals chant, but they don't talk like in our language. They don't talk. We have pastime of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu when he was traveling through Jharkhanda forest. I should show you this. I don't know who I was showing this picture. This painting, let me see if I can bring up. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was transversing through Jharkhand forest, and when he was chanting Hare Krishna, all the animals were, I think I was showing it to my children, all the animals were dancing with Mahaprabhu. Here I got it, I'm gonna show you. We were laughing so much that all the animals, the tiger is hugging everyone. Here, Let me see if it comes up here. See, Jharikhanda forest, Nama Prabhu is walking and he's chanting Hare Krishna. And it's so pure, all of them. See this, they're hugging this reindeer and tiger and everyone is dancing. Everyone is going mad. So Hare Krishna Mahamantra is a mantra of the soul. It's not, it has nothing to do with the body. So when we chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra, there is an insect in your house, a little ant, it will also get benefited. A plant, it will also get benefited.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Mataji, you can stop recording, Seema Mataji. Okay, Sanjay Gupta Prabhu. You can unmute.